Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all for being here. And nice to see some snow and some moisture in our on the ground, and hopefully it'll kind of recharge our aquifer. And I know it takes years and years, but the Ski Valley is, I'm sure, enjoying it, and the people that likes to ski. So I'd like to go ahead and call this meeting of January 13th to order. It, for the record, it is 1:05. If you'll call roll, please.
Renee. Mayor Barrone?
Present.
Councilmember Hahn?
Here.
Councilmember Peralta?
Here.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Here.
Councilmember Cantu?
Here.
Mr. O'Connell, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance? Yes, sir.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If you'll remain standing for a few minutes for a brief moment of silence, you know, we, as our community continues to grow and move forward, that we might have the ability to make decisions for our community and those in our community that have passed, and the families that continue to move forward with their losses, and just have that moment of silence for those families in our community. Thank you. Council, we have approval of the agenda. I know under presentations, item under 8B, the presentation by the Arts Council, that will be removed from the agenda. The gentleman that was going to do that presentation is not available. He called and let us know that. So anything else, Council?
Move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, we do have a motion to approve and a second. Mr. Lopez, did you have something?
After this motion.
Okay, call for the vote.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Mr. Lopez?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I just wanted to note that the mayor and council met in a closed meeting outside an open meeting on December 22nd of 2014 to discuss pending or a matter regarding pending or threatened litigation. That we met in the closed meeting, and nothing other than what was listed on the notice of the closed meeting outside an open meeting was discussed, and no action was taken.
So, Council, do we have a motion to accept the town attorney's report on that meeting?
So move.
We have a motion and a second. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
So we'll go ahead and move.
Mr. Mayor, I have an announcement I want to say to you. I would like to ask for a special meeting on Friday the 16th of this year. To meet the 72-hour public notice meeting to discuss the employment of the town manager. And I would like no discussion and no media coverage until after this meeting is held.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
No.
So we'll go on to approval of minutes, December 9th, 2014, regular meeting minutes.
Move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
Second. Yep. And a second. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
So item B, December 16th, 2014, special meeting minutes.
Move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
And motion to have a second.
Second.
Any further discussion? Not, call for the vote.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
So December 23rd, 2014, regular meeting minutes?
Move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
We have a second to that motion?
Second.
Any discussion? Not, call for the vote.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Move on to awards and recognitions, Employee of the Month. Turn that over to our HR director.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. This afternoon, we would like to recognize the Employee of the Month for January for the Town of Taos, and the employee is Mildred Martinez. She's the payroll. Mildred is the payroll administrator for the Town of Taos, and we would like to present her with this certificate, acknowledging her for her outstanding dedication and extraordinary attention to detail and positive attitude. The Town of Taos is privileged to have such a dedicated and talented employee working with us. Thank you so much, Mildred. And you also get a day of leave, a personal leave, and also some gift certificates. Thank you so much.
Again, Mildred, thank you so much for the service that you and the time you've dedicated to the Town of Taos. And I know you have a couple more items that you'd like.
Yes. With your permission, Mr. Mayor, I would also like to call up a couple of new employees that we've recently just hired. I'd like to introduce them to the community and to the council and the mayor. And the first employee I will call up is Mr. Matt Spriggs. Mr. Matt Spriggs was a previous employee of the town and has graciously come back to help us out in our planning department, and we are very welcome to have him back. Thank you so much. And the next employee I will call up that we've recently just hired is Linda Sanchez, and I'm sorry, Matt Spriggs was hired as of January 6th, 2015. And the next employee I will call up is Linda Sanchez. She's our new animal control officer, and she was hired as of December 24th. Started with us on Christmas Eve. And Linda, thank you so much. Thank you.
We have one other item B, and it's the appointment of a youth council member. And counselors, you know, this was one of those appointments that this young man came to me. He had some very concerns about our community. He had wanting to learn more about our local government, about government in general. And I took the opportunity to ask him if he would be willing to serve as our youth council. He agreed to that, so he will be joining us as our new youth council, and his name is Shay Moon. He's a senior at the high school, and it's a great opportunity for us to incorporate the youth within our community to be part of the governmental body. And you know, I went to the HR and I asked what was the proper process to move this forward, and basically they walked me through it. So this is the next portion of that is ratification by the council. So I don't see Mr. Moon in the audience. We did, I believe he still had class today, and he will be attending our meetings, and then he will also be shadowing me on Thursdays on the if there is appointments set up or different things, that field trips that we'll be taking, he'll be accompanying me during those on Thursdays. So just looking for ratification for the council for Mr. Shay Moon as our youth council.
Excuse me, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to mention that Shay said that if he was able to make it this afternoon, that he will try to stop by, but it might be a little bit later.
Okay.
And so if he does show up this afternoon, I will let you know, and that way he can be introduced to the council at that time.
So, So that's where it stands.
Were there any other candidates, Mr. Mayor, or was that?
There was not. We did put out, a request, and this is the gentleman that came forward.
How will that work with his school schedule? I know in the past when we had our youth counselors, we had our meetings at 6 p.m., so it was a little easier for them to...
He has an open schedule in the afternoons on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and a block of time that has been set aside for him to basically follow government.
Awesome. So move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
We have a motion to move. We have a second to that?
I'll second.
Okay. I'll call for the vote.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Okay. This next presentation, Amy, I'm going to turn it over to you. It's a great opportunity.
Right now, we would like to recognize two recently graduated police cadets. We have Officer Luke Martinez. He was hired with the town of Taos as a police cadet in June 16th of last year and went through the police academy, and now he is a certified police officer for the town of Taos. And so we would like to present him with this plaque of recognition for his accomplishment.
And Mr. Martinez, if you would, if you have family here, I would love you to invite them up, because I think it's a big portion of the office. Mr. Martinez, if you want to join your family, your sister, and the way it reads is, to whom these present may come, greeting, know ye that the mayor of town of Taos, New Mexico, by virtue of the authority vested in the office by the laws of the town of Taos, reposing special trust and confidence in you, Mr. Luke J. Martinez, does hereby constitute, appoint, and commission him as patrol officer. Welcome aboard, sir.
Okay, the other officer that we would like to recognize this afternoon is Officer James R. Suazo. Mr. Suazo has been with the town of Taos for a while. He was hired with the town of Taos as a recycling operator in October of 2001. And through very much hard work and dedication, I'm proud to say that we would like to, he became a police cadet as of March 2014, and then also went to the academy. At this time, we would like to call up his family to be with him while the plaque is presented. These two officers graduated from the New Mexico Department of Public Safety on Friday, December 19th, after 17 long weeks.
And again, thank you for your willingness to serve. The Town of Taos Police Department Commission, to whom these present may come, greetings, know that ye, the mayor of the town of Taos, New Mexico, by virtue of the authority vested in that office by the laws of the town of Taos, reposing special trust and confidence in James R. Suazo, sir, does hereby constitute, appoint, and commission him as patrol officer. Welcome aboard, sir.
Congratulations.
Council, any words of wisdom for our new officers?
Welcome aboard, and please stay safe out there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your willingness.
Thank you.
Okay, as we move down the agenda, the next item is under citizens forum, citizens wishing to speak. You know what, before I go on, Chief, did you like to share a few words for your officers?
I can give a 5-second answer in 20 minutes.
Okay. sorry,
I'm timing
that.
You.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Mr. Manager, and ladies and gentlemen. I don't know if people understand the full process that these guys have gone through. I mean, it starts off with a physical assessment and then into a written test and then oral interviews and then a real extensive background. The backgrounds normally take about 2 months to go through. And then we sit and we really decide if it's a good fit or if it isn't a good fit. And then they begin their training. And all told, it takes about a full year. And during that full year, in essence, if they sneeze wrong, they're going to get fired. And they know that. This is a tremendous pressure cooker for them. And just the fact that they're willing to step in the slot in the first place is pretty amazing. But just the amount of pressure and how much they have to learn really can seem to be insurmountable at times. And so I think we picked two excellent people, and so far they're doing great. And we fully expect them to have a long, illustrious career. And I'm very, very honored that you would pick our department. And we thank you very much for being part of our family. So thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Good job, Chief.
I know we also have our Judge Chavez, in the audience. I don't know if he'd like to. Thank you for being here. And if you'd like to, you're welcome.
Good afternoon. You'd really have to congratulate these gentlemen, all of those gentlemen back there dressed in black, all of them, because in this day and age, it really blows my mind as to why anybody would want to be a police officer. Look at what's happening in Albuquerque, throughout the nation, the way people are disrespecting our police officers. I think that's a great disservice to them. They provide you with the safety, with everything you need, and for people to disrespect them like that is very, very, very bad. I ask the people of Taos to please support your local police department. They're doing a great job. They protect us. They love you guys. Otherwise, they wouldn't be there dressed in black, okay? Congratulations, guys.
Thank you.
All of you, not only the two appointed, but all of you.
I also want to recognize Commissioner Jim Fambro sitting in the audience. Thank you for being here, Mr. Fambro. So we'll go on to Citizens Forum. The citizens wishing to speak shall have the opportunity to do so, and we'll limit them to 5 minutes. No action will be taken. Anybody in the audience that is willing or wanting to speak? Mr. O'Connell?
How you doing, Mayor?
Real good. And yourself, sir?
Good afternoon. There's a few things I'll make
it
quick.
If you'll sit at the mic so that they can record it and pull it towards you and your name for the record. So it's
Philip Alexander Econom with Not Forgotten Outreach. There's a few things that I wanted to talk about. One is I read the paper this week that Bobby Gonzalez wants to impose the gas tax here in New Mexico up 5 cents to 2019. Well, I'm all for that. But you know what? Our roads, our state roads in Taos and Taos County are appalling. And then in order to do that, we need to get the money fuddled here. It's great they repaved the road from the horseshoe all the way up to the beginning of town, but the rest of the town. I don't know if any of you have driven South Side Paseo. Holes are getting pretty big over there. You know, and now the gas prices are down. Yeah, the tax could be implemented, but we need to make sure that money gets funneled here to Taos to make sure that our infrastructure is better, especially on the main state roads. And it's getting really bad. And when I first moved here in 1997, roads were nice. They were really nice. And also we gotta make sure they don't do, excuse my French, a half-assed job like they did in El Prado. This needs to be addressed. Before he even implements this tax, we need to make sure we get the money here to Taos to get these roads fixed and make our town look a little better for the tourists coming in. That's the whole thing, you know. Second, the panhandling has been getting very aggressive here in Taos. There's a guy down the street, across the street from the Northside Diner, has been out of gas for about 2 weeks now. And that's also a reflection on our town also, you know, outside of Walmart and other places in town too. I mean, aggressively panhandling. It needs to be addressed. I talked with the chief of police about this. There is no city ordinance, but we need to do something about this, you know, and it's getting worse. And third, I've addressed this before twice last year about the aggressive selling of the newspapers. On Ranchitos and Salazar Road, I've been in almost 6 accidents there over the last year. One was last week. The guy goes out, stops traffic from turning left on Salazar, onto Salazar Road going south, and there's almost always accidents about to happen. Or if not, there has been some that have occurred. And that needs to be addressed. I don't think there should be even selling newspapers on that intersection at all because of how busy it is and also how dangerous it is, not only for the person selling the newspapers, but people traveling in their cars throughout that intersection. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Phil.
Mr. Mayor.
Councilor?
With regards to the panhandling, I think we looked at that, Floyd, about a year and a half ago. And if you could correct me if I'm not wrong, it's a constitutionality issue with regards to having the ability to sell on the side of the road, or even I think we looked at under our busker ordinance, right, Chief? So, Chief, if you don't mind maybe addressing that for the public.
Mr. Mayor, members of council, Mr. Measure. Last year we started looking at the panhandling ordinance, and then we also looked at the street sales of the newspapers. There is 2 separate ordinances. One ordinance deals with vending on the roadway and newspaper sales. It was specifically enumerated as having authorization to do street sales. They were the only entity that's allowed to do the sales. And then when it came to panhandling, we started off with the busker ordinance, and then that was repealed, and then we moved into panhandling ordinance. From the panhandling ordinance, Mr. Caldwell and I at the time were entered into a dialogue with the ACLU, and we actually had some pretty good conversations, and I know Mr. Caldwell did. And so it really has kind of been a person panhandling is a reflection of the economic community or the economic status of the community. This is what the ACLU says, and that it is a form of protected speech, and that it is not something to be interfered with. However, we are allowed to deal with people that are aggressive in nature, people who obstruct right-of-ways, people who are standing on the corner if they're obstructing the golden triangle for vehicles leaving. So there are some criteria that we can deal with. We really specifically started focusing on this due to the panhandling and some other miscellaneous issues that we've had inside the plaza. And from that, we actually resolved that in a manner away from law enforcement. Basically, what we did in the morning, I'd get a cup of coffee and sit amongst the group of them, and in the afternoon, get a cup of coffee and sit amongst the group of them. And after about 3 weeks, they decided they didn't like having coffee with me, and they moved on. And that's kind of the approach that we're doing, really, is if people get to the point they're actually obstructing the things that we talked about, we actually just pay attention to them and talk to them and see if we can figure out a better resolution to it. Okay. In a nutshell, that's kind of where we're at right now.
Thanks, Chief. I appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks. Okay.
Philip, we do have a meeting with the DOT scheduled later on for this month, but I agree with you. The Highway 68 is like driving on the moon. It's horrible.
It's terribly horrible. And, you know, you see the new road coming into town from the south? And then from the west, from the bridge, mm-hmm. and then get to our town. And what are these people? You know, what do these people think they're going to come spend money here and stay here and enjoy Taos? And we can't even accommodate them a nice ride through the town. And you know, like I said, when I moved here in '97, the roads were perfect. I don't know what happened and how come the upkeep wasn't kept on them.
Chief, if I could ask you one more question, and thanks for bringing that up, Phil. We had looked at doing the light on Estes Road. And traffic, I live within that area, and traffic has gotten extremely bad since they put the new charter school in,
yes,
to where Diamond Plaza is. Was there traffic studies done with regards to the placement of that school? Because, I mean, it's gotten bad. Come 8 o'clock and 3 p.m. It's another school zone.
Yeah, if there was, I was never notified of a traffic study. So I don't know. I do know that the DOT has been doing a series of traffic studies up through the corridor, but I don't know about that intersection. I do know that SDS and Pueblo Sur has had a couple fatalities, and numerous collisions at the intersection, and I will trust the traffic engineers know how best to control that. I would assume a signalized approach would be probably the best idea.
Mr. Spriggs, now that you're on board with us, could I get you to take a look at, I guess, that area with regards to ordinance and whether or not it falls within our jurisdiction to, I guess, even look at? I mean, one, there's no signage that it's a school zone, but it's been dubbed as that, and just whether or not that application process was followed through, just because of the safety concerns that lie within that area at around 8 a.m. and 3 p.m. when school's letting out.
If I may also follow up on a request from the council from previous, we talked about having the school zones, the end of the school zone, better marked, well marked because they're not marked. And so we looked at Gustorf behind the high school and figure out ways to make it a little bit better. And we also went through and looked at all the school zones and found that a number of the areas are missing entry school zones and also exit school zones. So, and I sent an email to the council. That's still something on the plate. If the council would like me to proceed with that, then we start doing cost analysis and figure out how to proceed on that measure.
Please proceed.
Okay. All right.
And Chief, and there is a meeting, well, there's a proposed meeting set up with the Department of Transportation, 27th, 28th, I believe, is the tentative date. And, you know, and some of these issues couldn't be brought up to the Department of Transportation because the majority of the roadway that Mr. O'Connell was talking about is state highway. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's something that we had planned to, it's already in the books to discuss those areas because we know that they're becoming deteriorated, and we're wanting to know if there's money or what we can do to try to get it to the top of the list to get those roads looked at. So, thank you.
Thanks, Chief. Thank you, Phil.
Please, just come up and so you can.
In regards to the intersection of SDS Road and Paseo de Pueblo Sur, that's my neighborhood. That intersection, like Councilman Gonzalez said, it's getting really sporty. And yes, I've seen the accidents where the fatalities have happened, and that place needs to be addressed big time because not only does rapid speeding go through there from the south more than from the north, it needs to be, I think, patrolled a little bit more. And also, yeah, lights need to be put there. Lights seriously need to be put there. And it's also a mess, too, because of the illegal parking that happens outside of ACE, too. Dennis put up fire zones, and people still ignore it and still park in there, and it makes it hard to get in and out of there. So it's all congested right there with people turning left into the ACE hardware store from the north side and turning right in from the south side. It's terrible. And like I said, I live in that neighborhood, and I avoid that intersections between the hours of 8 and 10 and maybe 3 and 6. And it's just, it's awful. It's very scary, as a matter of fact. And what, do we got to wait for someone else to die before something else is done there? Yeah. You know, seriously, we've had two fatalities last year.
And I believe a light has been approved for that.
But I know these things take time, but yeah. It needs to get done like yesterday.
Thank you.
All right.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, Phil.
Anybody else? This is under Citizens Forum. Please. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. Good afternoon, good. Mr. Mayor, Council. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jeremy Romero, and I've been around Taos for a while. I grew up in northern New Mexico, but I moved to Taos in 1999 and worked for the Blakes for about 8 years, and I'm a senior, well-seasoned river guide now, and so I know a lot of, you know, about the tourism part of the area and how the economy works and such. But today I'm here to talk about our business. My family and I have a small business here in town. It's called JR Clothing We are on the corner of Paseo del Pueblo Sur and Camino de la Placita. And we have been doing business with the town of Taos, the county, the state, the mine, lots of different municipalities, the lab, different companies, tourists, and Taosanos alike. Recently I've been noticing a trend, especially amongst the town of Taos departments in their procurement procedures to not support local businesses as much as they used to in the past, and it's getting worse and worse every year. The internet, of course, just like you know, the rest of the world, is taking over things, and a lot of times, just like a couple weeks ago, I was following up with one of the departments on a quote I had given them about 4 months ago for some footwear, safety toe footwear that's required for the staff, and learned that not only that I didn't get the bid, which was okay, whatever. Hopefully someone else here in town did. Turns out they went to the internet. And I was like, oh, well, you know, and I straight up asked them, I was like, do you mind telling me where you went? And I said, well, we found a cheaper price online. I said, well, that's unfortunate. And she's like, well, you know, it's the best price. I said, well, all right, you know. So of course she was just doing her job. And I don't think it's important to name any names or departments because that really doesn't matter. What does matter is I think that the town should lead by example, and I know the town's been involved with the County Chamber of Commerce in trying to support shopping small, shopping local. Even the mayor, well, former mayor, had a commercial on the radio talking about supporting local businesses, and it's a little frustrating because I know firsthand that the actual town of Taos is not supporting local businesses. I've become acquainted with several of the road department guys that work at the parks, and they're in there not only when they're told to, you know, go buy boots when the time comes around every year, but just for their own personal reasons to as far as buying clothes and stuff. And we talk, and they tell me what's going on. And another example that I learned of was that one of the departments was getting boots from a business out of Santa Fe, a place called Boot Barn, and they were really disappointed with the customer service and the back and forth. I guess they didn't have to drive over there, but you know, the time and energy that is spent on trying to save a couple pennies actually sometimes snowballing into spending more money. You know, it seems like you're spending a little less money. Oh, look at on the internet or a Santa Fe company, an Albuquerque company. Oh, there's our best price. You know, we're looking good for our boss. I'm going to get a raise because I'm under budget, whatever the situation may be. But, you know, in the long run, it ends up taking, you know, more manpower, more time, more research on the internet, whatever it is, when they could just come down to a local business and get what they need and get good customer service. And if it doesn't fit right, they could, you know, instead of having to ship it off and wait and wait and wait. I've heard of people waiting 4 to 6 months for shoes they had been waiting on. That had been approved, and it's just because the back and forth, and it just, you know, there's so many reasons for, I mean, convenience and simplicity, but I mean, of the internet, but I mean, there's so many reasons to support local businesses. I mean, and my family, I mean, we almost didn't make it here in Taos. We considered shutting our doors down last year, and just being done because it's just has gotten so bad. But things actually, fortunately, recently have gotten better. And, you know, we've made it now seven. We opened in 2007, so we're almost 8 years in. And it's been tough. This is a tough little town to do business in. And even as little as the town may spend with us, it really does make a difference. And it exposes our products to the rest of the community, and it really helps. And even if we don't get the business, you know, I would like to see our competitors even I hate to say it, but even the Taos Walmart get the business because it's actually supporting Taosanos that work there, even though the money goes wherever, you know, Sam Walton lives. But it's pretty sad. So anyways, I would like to see the town maybe mandate it somehow that they have to shop locally. And it can stop there. It doesn't stop there with just uniforms for guys that are digging ditches. You know, it could go as far as into our schools where they could be getting apples from Dixon or vegetables from Cerro Vista Farms for the school lunches, goods and services that are available here in Taos that the town needs and uses, I think should always be given to local businesses. At least, I mean, and of course it has to be fair, it has to be put out to bid, but I mean, the local economy really depends on us spending our money here, and I know you guys know this. I don't have to tell you about that at all. It's a fact. But the fact that the town of Taos is not mandated by law to shop locally is something that concerns me and something that I would like to see changed. And, you know, I know that this town is small, and a lot of times it's really hard to find something you're looking for. But if you give us, you know, a minute, we can find it for you. If you, you know, if you want to make something happen, you have the money. I'm sure there's someone in this town that'd be more than willing to get you or your people whatever you need, whether it be goods or services, to perform your duties as a town municipality.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Romero.
That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Marietta, if I could ask you a real quick question under procurement guidelines.
And I think we just had a training on this a couple of days ago.
Actually, yesterday.
Yesterday. Yeah. When it comes under guidelines of procurement with regards to expenditures, I know we don't always have to take the lowest bid. What's the dollar threshold that allows us to do that? I mean, there's some wiggle room inside there with regards to timeliness, and I mean, it doesn't always revolve around price. I know that.
It's usually about price, unless you put specific things in that bid that will weigh it to be not just price, but it's usually with services and not with tangible or goods like this. So it's really hard. I know in our procurement policy, we ask the departments to do a local, to try local, get local quotes, but we also need 3 quotes. And so, you know, I know they make the due diligence, and I understand the gentleman that the small businesses here, they depend on, you know, a lot of people to go, I mean, town, county, but the procurement code is about best obtainable price and quality. And, you know, if they get something and they're not happy the next time they go out, well, then they can take that quality of service that they did receive in the past and maybe do it and include, you know, quality of service or timeliness or whatever. I need this in, you know, a week or whatever it may be. So we try.
So the DHs can kind of formulate their bid request for timeliness and ease of return and whatever it is, I mean, that can fit a local business's needs at the same time. And I guess what I'm looking for is, I mean, the vitality behind a local business versus shopping out of town is that dollar evolves, I mean, it's proven 50 times. So for me, it's wanting to find a medium. I understand the whole aspect that we could get gouged in some instances. I know the protection behind procurement. But at the same point, I know we've gone as far as even looking bid preference, local bid preference of,
right,
you know, 10% or, you know, whatever the case may be. Because sometimes it's just that little dollar amount that they need to be put over the edge.
And the bid preference would be good. It'd be local. We'd probably have to go to the state and pass some kind of, introduce something to do that at a local level. We did get a local vendor using the state 5% preference, and they were awarded some vehicles. But, you know, it's hard with anything under the amount that the state doesn't allow you to do.
And what is that dollar amount?
No, it's not just the dollar amount. It's just the preference itself,
preference.
The 5% preference.
So can Mr. Romero qualify under that 5% state preference? Because I'm sure this online company wasn't qualified as in-state.
I don't know the specifics on this one, but he can. I think they all can qualify a 5% preference for local, and it may, that's something we can look at.
Go ahead, Mr. Romero.
I'm sorry, I've lost you. What is the 5%?
Council Peralta.
Mr. Mayor, the 5% preference is for any business within the state of New Mexico. So you against an out-of-state. So if the internet provider was in Colorado, then you or anybody in the state of New Mexico could get a 5% preference. In other words, you can go over their price by 5% to get the contract. However, the question I have for you, Marietta, is that under our procurement rules, you have the requirements for purchasing, let's say if you're under $1,000, you get three phone calls. If you're from $1,000 to $10,000, it's three written bids. If it's over $10,000, then it has to be sealed bids.
Right.
So if you're buying shoes or clothes, can you set up so that each time that they purchase is a separate purchase rather than getting a year quote, so that you could do things more locally than pushing the price out to where you get a bigger market?
And actually right now each department does their own procurement for each one of their uniforms. So there's probably four or five separate small bids that go out for each of the departments. So we're already sort of doing that.
But is that for the year or is it each time they purchase?
It is for the length of time that they need. I mean, they need their boots for the year or every 6 months. So it's for the use of it. So it's probably a year's quote, one time for this year. And we actually would like to get them all together, which probably would not help either. So what we're doing right now is the best we can do to, I think, help the local vendors. But, you know, in discussing with our training yesterday, some of those things came up. Yeah, it takes longer to go to Espanol if you have to go pick them up, or the shipping cost. So they take that all into consideration. So you can just review with the departments again and, you know, check everything out that they've been doing and see what their concerns are, why, what it is all about. But that's how it's been flowing right now.
Mr. Romero, you do business in other parts of the state as well, too, like Espanola, Los Alamos. What's the likelihood, Marietta, through state procurement, that he could go into the state office and become a preferred state vendor in that arena, or best price state vendor?
That's a possibility, too. I don't know the next procurement coming out on uniforms. I haven't looked on the state procurement website to see what they have, but we can help him or direct him on what to do to try to get that side and try to get the 5% preference. If I'll just get his name and we can see what we can help him or any other local businesses that we can in that sense.
Good. Please do. Thank you.
What is the name of that organization or that?
It'd be the New Mexico State Purchasing Agent.
And then you want to become a preferred vendor? Is that what it's called?
Yes. Well, yeah. They solicit quotes from you as a vendor to be on the states, where then you just give them you may quote it and they may select you along with other vendors throughout the area or the state. So it's a bid process also, but you're on there and then we don't have to go again through the procurement process, and maybe your rate, your cost for some of your things will be competitive there, and then we could use you in that fashion too, and other municipalities or governments around.
And what it does is set you up throughout the state of New Mexico. So if you have, let's just say, for example, steel toe boots, and you give a set price on those steel toe boots, and they can automatically go to that list and see what the price is, they may not even have to go out because it's already a best price given. I mean, they'll still, yeah. But it at least puts you in touch with other municipalities as well, too. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, and Marietta, you know, as we came into office, you know, that was something that we stressed, is trying to buy as much local as possible, and I think that's why even on the vehicles, they went back out to bid to try to get that local purchase. So we will continue to do that, something we've done since we've been in office, and we will continue to do that. And I want to say I'm a customer of Mr. Romero's, been for many years. So.
Mr. Mayor, Marietta, can you check on the state site and see when the next time is that it'd be open for people to bid?
Yes.
And let's set up a workshop for the local businesses that we can get the word out to show them how to get the 5% preference
okay.
For being a New Mexico business, and then also help them complete the forms.
Okay.
And that bid timeline should be, I think Councilor Peralta said, about March or April, so it's coming up.
So we'll have to work on that soon so that we have them in the system before.
Okay.
We'll work on that.
And that's something the chamber could also chip in on their resources to help out, since there is a short time to get that together.
Yeah, will do. Marietta, I have a question. With the vastness of the accounting programs that there is now, is there any way of monitoring how much we're actually saving going out of town or internet, or is there any way?
We don't keep track of the bids per se, lowest and highest. In that sense, we'd probably have to combine them and calculate it or do some kind of spreadsheet on it, because we only have in the system whoever's been awarded a bid or whatever it may be. So we have the information on them, but we don't have information on the highest bidders or the ones, the savings between the two of them. Mm-hmm. But the departments could probably run something, you know, internally, because they keep all their information.
Yeah, because I always like the paper trail is what I always request, is the documentation. But, you know, I know it's really time consuming, and I was just wondering with, you know, the accounting programs, what they are, if it was something that could be just put into the system to monitor it.
It could if that's something we want to take a look at, but it would take some additional time. But I've seen procurements in between both that they're close to a few dollars and a close to $100 or 200 more. So there's a variety of different scenarios that they are competitive, and then some that are not competitive. And we've worked with the ones that have been that close.
Awesome. Thank you, Marietta.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Romero.
Thank you.
Anybody else? No.
Stephen? Excuse me, Mayor, Council. Oh. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I need to go back to the motion that was made earlier by Councilmember Cantu. And the reason is that we need 72 hours to post that agenda, and I will need to post it within the next few hours. So I didn't get to write down your entire motion. I don't know if you have it written, if you can email it to me. But if you guys can let me know what time on Friday you want to meet and where, that way I can have Francella start setting up a meeting.
I can email it to you.
Your motion?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it has the time and the location that you want to meet as well?
I can put that on there.
Okay.
Yeah, right, you might want to make the motion again, because we'd have to. Because I will not be available till after 4 o'clock on Friday. I have a funeral of my uncle to attend to at 12 noon. So.
And the same holds true for me. So I have commitments on Friday. Better discuss it.
Okay, well, I guess after 4 o'clock is fine.
And then no action will be taken?
Here.
Was that part of your motion?
Not today. No discussion or no media coverage today.
But for the motion.
Oh, yes.
On the agenda item?
Yes.
No action will be taken.
No, she said.
No, you take
no action today.
No action today, but action on Friday.
Possible action on
possible
Friday.
Action.
Possible.
And it'll be an open session then?
Yes.
Oh, it's not executive session.
No.
Okay.
Put the location
here. And it's then a special session.
Location will be here.
Here?
At 4?
I think, right?
Well, what time is the availability of?
It'll be after 4, anytime after 4.
So we'll say 4:30.
I mean, by 12 o'clock, I think of funerals in Pahuake, an hour for the funeral, an hour for the burial, an hour to see the family, and an hour to get back, you know, maybe 5 o'clock.
Yeah, 5 o'clock would be good.
And it's a special session under the Open Meetings Act? Open meeting?
Yes.
And Councillor, open to the public?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. At 5 p.m. Friday?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Renee.
Buenos dias, Stevens Hall.
On matters from the staff, 10A, there's a reference to the Defense Logistic Revitalization Program. I wonder if this is part of the, has anything to do with the Defense Logistics Agency, which is affiliated with the U.S. Department of Defense. And so when you discuss it, if you would go into, you know, some detail as to what this is all about. With respect to executive sessions, 14A refers to the exemption of paragraph H7 and 14B, the exemption of paragraph H8. 7 refers to meeting subject to the attorney-client privilege pertaining to threatened or pending litigation. When you place these items on the agenda, I think it would be helpful. I know that I would enjoy at least knowing what the matter is. You don't obviously have to discuss the matter, but if you would, if this is pending litigation, then put the title of the suit, if there's a suit down here, and then with respect to what the matter is it in reference to a contract or whatever. I think that's probably public information anyway. If there is pending litigation, I could probably go to the court and find it. But I think it would be helpful and useful, and I don't think you're compromising anything by putting that, by disclosing that on the agenda. And with respect to H8, when you're talking about, H8 says, these are items that are not subject to the Open Meetings Act. 8 says, meetings for the discussion of the purchase, acquisition, or disposal of real property or rudder or water rights by the public body. With respect to water rights, water is such an important matter to this community and to many communities, not just in Southwest, but all over the world. And I think it's important enough that, again, that this community know what's being, where are these water rights coming from? Who's involved? And that's up to you. I mean, you can go into executive session, but I think it's important enough that water rights be discussed in open so that the public knows. I can hardly imagine anything more important to this community than the discussion of water rights. I'm sure there are, but water rights are right up there. So when you publish these notices, again, especially with pending litigation, simply put in, if there's a suit, what is a suit? Town of Taos versus so-and-so with regards to some sort of contract performance, whatever it may be, whatever the suit involves. And with respect to water rights, I wish you would give some consideration to discussing the matter in public so that the community knows. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. Council, could you comment on the Open Meetings Act and why we go into executive session when we're discussing water rights? It's not on, Floyd.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor, Councilor Hahn. The reason that all these matters are discussed in executive session is because of the confidential nature and the possibility of some adverse position that may be taken against the town if the matters were disclosed. But in answer to Mr. Hall's statement, the any actions taken on the water rights or with regard to any pending litigation or anything else, of course, is taken in public. But a lot of these matters are under the guise of attorney-client privilege or considering the purchase or disposition of real property or water rights. And for those reasons, discussions concerning that where no action is taken is prohibited or is not subject to disclosure under the Open Meetings Act.
Did you hear that, Stephen, because you were talking with him? So perhaps you could spend a few minutes with Floyd then. He just gave a reasonable explanation. And Chief, the defense logistics, I want to say that's the purchase of secondhand equipment and stuff. What's going on there? Okay, so you're going to talk about it then. Great.
And I appreciate what Floyd said, and I heard most of it, and I understand that. But again, when it comes to the simple matter, with respect to pending litigation, of putting that on the agenda. I don't see why that can't be done. You're not disclosing anything there that isn't probably all that isn't public, I'm certain. And as with respect to threatened litigation, I'm less certain about that. And again, with respect to water rights, I can understand again what Floyd said, but at the same time, that's up to you to make that decision. And I think it behooves you to take into consideration the community interest with respect to water rights. That's what I'm saying. I understand sort of the technical side of what Mr. Lopez was talking about. Thank you,
Mr. Mayor. I think with regards to the gentleman's question with regards to executive session, in the past we typically had seen what the executive session item was about. It didn't necessarily, you know, go into detail, but it was, you know, in this case, litigation between the town of Taos and Springditch. It doesn't need to go into any further detail beyond that, because any decision we come back and make will be done outside of executive session anyway. But I think it is informational for the general public to at least know what the items are, as opposed to I know Mr. Hall does his due diligence with finding what the 1015-1H7 and 8 codes read into, but the average person doesn't read that far into it. So thank you for the advice, and I think we should start to list that on our executive session items.
Mr. Lopez, this is something that you'd probably need to, you know, advise us on, and that's what we should be moving forward on. Look for your recommendation. Okay. So anyone else under Citizens Forum? If not, we'll go ahead and move on to matters from staff. Item A, 10A, out-of-state travel, defense logistic revitalization program. Chief Weaver, permission for repeated out-of-state travel for the town of Taos staff to retrieve items awarded from the defense logistics program. Mileage and per diem costs will be based on pickup location.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor, members of council, Mr. Manager. I guess I could start by going off of Mr. Hall and his question. The Defense Logistic Revitalization Program is a program by which the United States government can get rid of its excess surplus. And what this program allows, it allows government agencies to pick up some of these items for free or no cost. The program that we're in is designed for law enforcement, and so what happens is we'll put in a request, and if it's awarded to us, we have 2 weeks to pick it up. And then that item has to be used for law enforcement purposes for a year. After that, the agency has an option to retain it or to sell it or to transfer it to somebody else. So what I gave to you right now is the sheet of things that we've gotten. Now, to be sure, a law enforcement agency can take a path that a path of basically militarizing themselves, get armored personnel carriers and weapons and things of that nature. If we were in a community in which I thought that was needed, I would absolutely go for those items. Town of Taos, we don't have those needs. We have needs for different infrastructure setups. So one of the first things that we went for was actually a kennel. And this kennel is a dog kennel. We got it from the Air Force. And this is normally retails for right in the area of $12,000. This kennel is heated and air conditioned. It has a control unit on top. And it can actually expand open so you can hold more than one dog. So we have that. And this Saturday, I'm going to go to Stray Hearts and clean up the area where we're going to put it. And so what that will be used for is for our animal control officer. Whenever she picks up an animal after hours, she can actually put an animal in a climate-controlled area. And so that's the purpose of that. A side note is when I was talking to the director of Stray Hearts, he was talking about many times people have dropped off litters of puppies and kittens. And provided that we're not using it, I think
that would be an okay usage for that kennel even in the first year. I can certainly justify that. So from that, we've also picked up a washer and dryer. The washer and dryer was going to go to Stray Hearts. And they actually ended up getting a donation of money that was specifically set for a laundry facility for them. So the washer and dryer instead is, we're probably going to take that to the CAV for victims. And so we're going to put it inside there. We just recently got two trailers. When I say trailers, these are double-axled enclosed trailers. The steam cleaner is a trailer-mounted steam cleaner. Use that for the patrol cars, keep them clean, but then also for special events or if we have a need to get a street cleaned up very, very quickly, we have the capability without calling out the fire department. The radios, it's a series of 20 handheld radios that we can program for the patrol staff. Those are going to be UPS'd to us. We're working on that right now. There's a climbing wall. And the climbing wall, I really intend, we're working on physical standards for the police officers who are already, who have been grandfathered in. So as it stands right now, when a police officer applies, they have to pass physical fitness, they have to go through the academy, pass all the standards, and that's the last time we talk about physical fitness. So we're developing a physical fitness program throughout the year for the officers. That's going to be part of it. We can also use that for public relations. And then there's a pack and a blanket called blanket bed, actually is a sleeping bag. So another aspect of this was for us to start, Mr. Bellis and I are working towards really increasing our emergency management capabilities, where if we have another water outage or another heat outage, we actually have the capability to respond to the community with items that will keep them alive. And so that's the goal. Now, when we are awarded something, we are given 2 weeks to pick up those items. Quite frankly, I didn't expect for us to get this many items this quickly. This is less than a month's worth of work. I actually kind of had to put a hold on it until we get a handle with the stuff that we already have. We're going to need the check marks that I did on the right-hand side. Those are four different vehicles we need to take up, four different trucks. And the rest of the stuff we can load onto one of the trucks. So you can see we need to go to Golden, Colorado, pick up the two trailers, and then to Colorado Springs and another trip to Golden to pick up the steam cleaner and the climbing wall. What I'm requesting permission to have an ongoing permission from the council for us to go out of state to pick up these items when they come due, primarily because we have a two-week turnaround. I was able to get an extension on the climbing wall and the steam cleaner, and I was led to believe that we shouldn't ask for extensions very often. I guess there's enough demand for the stuff that when we're awarded, we need to get to it. Now, the exact costs for the trip, I really don't know. When we send people to Golden, Colorado, I assume that will be an overnight trip. The rest of these things, I'm hoping to be a day trip. In addition, we're keeping our search to primarily New Mexico and Colorado. However, we're also asking for large equipment. So, for instance, front-end loaders, et cetera. If we were to find a front-end loader in Wyoming or Oklahoma, it actually may be very cost-efficient for us to transport that commercially. Those large items, I would need to come back to the council and actually get your permission to see if we can expend those funds. So to kind of wrap this all around, this is actually a pretty good way for the police department and the town to supplement our resources. The cost of these items is the cost to pick them up or to have them mailed to us. When we have approval, we have about 2 weeks to move on it. And we have already begun to get wish lists from other departments to see what items they're requesting, to see if we can make that law enforcement related. And that's where we're at right now. So the request is for you to allow us throughout this fiscal year, I'd imagine we'll come back again the next fiscal year, for us to accommodate these travel expenses.
And Councilman Peralta?
Commissioner Chief.
Sorry.
Yes, sir. My question is related to the budget for the travel or cost to bring these things in.
What do we have available in that budget? And what is your guesstimate as to what it'll cost to go to Golden overnight and come back? Depending upon the equipment you got to take over there to pick up this stuff. So.
Exactly. The trip to Golden, I'm estimating that will probably be in the area of about $500-ish. In the police department budget as it stands right now, we're holding approximately $8,000 for travel per diem throughout this for this final fiscal year. And that is...
I'm sorry, give me that again. Is that 80,000?
No, 8,000, sir.
8,000.
8,000.
Where are you going?
I think if I had $80,000, Ms. Fambro would probably tackle me out of the chair, and then I would have some funds reallocated very quickly. And this does turn to be a cost analysis. And
let me ask you this question, I guess, in relation to that, to get a little better definition. How many trips do you think that you will need to take? In other words, how many times during now and July 1st will the Homeland Security or wherever you're getting this equipment from offer you equipment? I mean, so far they've offered you quite a bit in a very short period of time.
They really have. And as a matter of fact, I think I'm going to need to be kind of more picky about what we get. Looking at the climbing wall, I thought, and that was the first thing that hit, and I was so excited about it, I said yes. And now I'm saying, do I really need to have someone drive up to Golden, Colorado to pick up a climbing wall? So I think we really need to be kind of cautious about what we're doing. But in this short amount of time, we've already, there's four trips in a matter of about 2 weeks that we came up with.
Chief, real quick, with regards to that, as far as the trips, is there a possibility that most of this stuff is located within the same vicinity just to send a freight truck and pay that out that way to pick everything up in one shot as opposed to making individual trips, the $500?
I mean, absolutely. One of the ideas is, for instance, for these two trailers, if I had been more intelligent about this, I would have picked a bunch of smaller items and load the trailer up with them and then bring the trailer and those items back. There have been some departments that have actually ordered and got a flatbed truck and trailer and then loaded larger items on top of that and brought them all back in one trip. For this one right here, these four different things are all hitched. So the two trailers, I need two different vehicles, and the climbing wall, I need one vehicle, and the steam cleaner is on a trailer. So as much as what we can pack stuff into one load, obviously we want to go for.
And what I'm thinking is, like, the two trailers, the climbing wall, some of the bigger stuff, send on a 53-foot flatbed, semi, two-tows. I mean, because you can pick up everything in one shot. I would think that'd be more cost advantageous. And I've shipped cross-country from New Mexico to New York on large-scale items, a full flatbed truck for around $1,800, $1,900.
Wow.
So it would depend on, I think, what you're looking at, right, dollar-wise,
right,
weigh that out between freight and what it would be for here. Because right, they're always looking to backhaul things.
Right.
And New Mexico's kind of one of those states where... we backhaul a lot. I don't know if you do here, but and we used to backhaul quite a bit.
Well, and so. I never even thought about that. Thank you. Yeah.
But again, Chief, you just need to pay attention. I don't know as far as who will load you over there, if there's somebody that'll load you. I know logistics is going to be a big thing because, you know, if nobody's there to load you and they say there they are, it's up to you to get them on the truck. If there's not some way to load,
right,
it's not going to get on a.
Yeah,
I know because I do it all the time. So, I mean, it's one of them things you show up to a job site and say, well, there's your material, no way to get it off.
Right. This has been a steep learning curve for me in a very short amount of time. I've learned a whole lot.
Yeah. And I mean, sometimes, you know, depending on what we have available, you know, sometimes you can load a couple of these trailers, depending on how they're situated, even on a gooseneck.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we can get them backed up on there if they have a ramp and piggyback even one off the back and, you know, multiple pieces. But Councilor Peralta?
Well, we do have a semi and a flatbed.
Right.
That we could send over there if you didn't want to use a commercial entity from over there to bring them in. But my question is, how much of that $8,000 you have in travel is already asked for?
Already encumbered? Yeah, as it stands right now, Actually, we have 7,554 that's not encumbered. Now, I still have officers I want to send to training. I still have things that need to get done. So this first trip has been a good eye-opener for me. It's really neat that we're getting free stuff, but if I'm not being economical in the way that we get it, I've just defeated the purpose. So I really like Mr. Gonzalez's idea and your idea as well as to how to better get this stuff, pick it up. And so I certainly has not lost me that I need to figure out a better way of doing this.
The reason I'm asking the question is that your budget of $8,000 could go in a week.
Yeah, exactly, sir. Exactly.
And so this is the reason I'm asking for it, is because, you know, I like the idea of picking up all this surplus equipment if we have use for it. Right. But I don't want to get to a point where next week you don't have any money to go out and get it.
Exactly.
And the concern I have is that if you call up the feds and say, well, I'm sorry, but I don't have any way to pick this up, they're not going to offer it to you the next time.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
So that's my concern in saying, you know, concerning that we have sufficient funds in the budget to provide for the transportation or travel that's necessary to get this stuff in.
I hear you and I agree with you, sir.
So this is kind of like I saying, asking you what is the budget you need for this, and I guess the council would have to go back and see where we can find that.
Yeah.
If that's what the council wants to do.
And truth be known, unfortunately, I really don't know. I'm hoping for this trip to these four trips for me to be able to have a real good handle on exactly what it's going to cost to do things, and then go from there. I'm learning as I go, but thank God I'm willing to learn.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you.
So, Council, any more further comments? Not, what's the wishes of the Council?
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to move for approval of this item with the Chief actually checking into the options as stated, one being an LTL, which is an over-the-road carrier, looking at within our own departments whether or not we can allocate to get the items picked up. If not, last resort being able to go physically pick them up. Anytime we're offered, in a sense, free stuff, I'm sure the dollar amount of what we're receiving surely outweighs what it'll cost us to get it. So, Mr. Mayor, with that, I move for approval.
We have a motion. Do we have a second to that?
Second.
And a second. Any further discussion? Jay?
I was wondering, will this take officers off the street to go relieve this, or were you going to get other town employees to do it?
As it stands right now, it's actually going to be some of the administrative officers I have, so the administrative lieutenant and our sergeant in charge of accreditation.
I also volunteered to go if they needed somebody to drive. So I did. I mean, if they needed somebody.
Yeah, if you just need company, yeah. I'll go.
So, call for the vote.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hunt?
Yes.
Thank you so very much.
So we'll go to item B, out-of-state travel, animal control chief.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Mr. Manager, for our new animal control officer, we need to start getting her trained. Through the National Animal Care and Control Association, they offer a series of three courses. Each course is a week-long course. The very first course, which they term Module A, the closest course we found was actually in Arizona. Module B, we find being taught in New Mexico. So some of the wishes that I have is to get the animal control up to speed as quickly as possible. We had a meeting with members of the Stray Heart and the Animal League yesterday. We've been in a series of meetings asking the community what they want the animal control office to actually be and how they want it to actually function. Once again, I'm in uncharted territory, so it only makes sense for us to reach out to the people who know this better than we do. The recommendation from them was for Linda to obtain this training as well. So this initial training, Module A, is scheduled to be in Phoenix, Arizona, February 9th through the 13th. The cost of the course, I believe, is $585, and then the per diem for that. And so that is the request to allow her to go out of state for that first animal control instructional course.
Councilor Peralta.
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, the only concern I have on this is that we don't have an actual request in dollar figure for the travel, the tuition, and everything else. And normally for everything that we pass for out-of-state travel, we have all of that. The cost of hotel rooms, cost of meals, the cost of transportation, whether that's going to be by vehicle or by public transportation or whatever it is. And it concerns me that because if this is coming out of your $8,000,
yes, sir, it is.
We need to know what that is, because that reflects then upon what you can do with the first item we just approved. So, and then the same thing with each other course that you want to take, we should have a cost rundown for each one of those items in order for us to know that you have the money in your budget to take care of that. And that's part of what we're required to do for out-of-state travel by state statute.
Point well taken, sir. If it is possible, would we be able to table this and I can go and get the information to come back in about an hour? Would that be appropriate?
When does she leave,
Mr. Mayor? She would be leaving on February the 8th, taking a town vehicle. The hotel room that we found for her is $85 a night, and then $30 a day for food. So, doing my gazentas here.
And the travel is going to be in town vehicle?
Yes, sir.
How many days?
That is 5 days training, 1 day, or 2 days travel, and 5 days class.
And is there a cost on the class itself?
Yes, sir. That's $525.
And you said $85 a night?
Yes, sir.
$115
For per diem?
For per diem, it's $115
out of state. Does that include meals, or is that just lodging?
Per diem includes the meals.
Meals and lodging?
Meals
and lodging. So $115.
So the $85 a day that I said before is the cost of the room that we found for her. And so then $30 a day for food would come up to $115
a day?
Yes.
$115 includes whatever you found for her. That's just up here. $115 meal and food. She's not going on actual, right?
No.
Per diem.
Mr. Mayor, in regards to the cost coming out of the $8,000, since the position was originally budgeted at the beginning of the year to be in the planning department, it has been shifted to police, but we have not yet made that adjustment, which we'll do at the mid-year. The planning department travel budget could pay this directly if the chief could provide those numbers.
From my rough calculation right now, it'd be $1,330 for tuition and per diem. And then she would be in a town vehicle.
What did you say your travel year to date was, expenditure or spoken for?
$500.
So I'm sorry, what we have budgeted?
You had 8,000 total budgeted.
Yes, sir.
And you're gonna, and how much do you have right now?
That's what we have unencumbered right
total.
Now.
Total. Okay. Unencumbered.
$7,540.
Unencumbered.
Correct.
But the possibility of this not being out of that direct line, it could be out of the planning department.
Which would make me happy.
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, let me ask Mr. Bellis, in the budget for the planning department, did they have out-of-state travel in their budget for the different members of that department?
I believe there is travel for the building official to do the regular accreditation and for at least one zoning training, and there would have also been animal control in there, but I don't know if we used that up with the last animal control officer that we sent out. But then there's also mileage in there for training and other expenses.
Members of council, I stand corrected. That was going off the LAPF, off the general fund, which would be the civilian traveling per diem. I actually have $3,048, and so that would be the money that would this item would come out of. The
you can't take the class out of that. That has to come out of a different item.
Right.
The educational portion. You have two different budget items you'd be pulling out of.
I do. So in the budget, in the general budget, not the law enforcement protection fund, but in the general budget, for dues and registration, I have $5,000. And then for mileage and per diem, I have $3,000. So when we talk about travel for the Defense Logistics Administration, that'd be the $7,500. For the Animal Control, which is actually a civilian position, I have $3,000 for travel and $5,000 for dues and registration.
Okay. So there's adequate budget without any transfer from planning, which we still could do to replace the funds if we needed to.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And depending on other training that the chief may have for other officers, that'd come out of the $7,500.
Yes, sir.
So you feel confident about that, chief?
I do, sir.
Okay.
This is a very, very critical function. We are hitting this as hard as we can, and I really think that this deserves 150% push on our behalf. And animal control officers normally make four times the amount of contacts as law enforcement officers do. And this is kind of vital to the police department from a number of different angles. But the most important thing is I need to make sure that our animal control officer has as much training as possible so she doesn't get injured. And she got bit by a cat last week. And what can be a minor injury can actually, in actuality, be a pretty big deal. So we're really looking at everything we can do to make her as safe and then also as efficient and also get as much public feedback so we can actually go down a road and really try to make a difference with this.
Okay. Thank you.
Sir.
Move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
A motion. Do I have a second to that motion?
I'll second that.
Second to the motion. Any further discussion? None. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor, before you move to the next item, and while the chief is here, I also want to inform council and thank the chief that he's been very proactive on a number of fronts. And as soon as the position was moved to his department and we were getting some inquiries, he set up a meeting with the community animal advocates and went over their concerns along with the animal control officer and set some ground rules and parameters, which I think they were very reasonable. They understood that we're not gonna be sending somebody out 24 hours a day for a stray animal. And the shelter also participated, and I think there's really good, clear communication, and they were very thankful for that. And I also wanna point out that this is a savings to us in that this is a consolidation. It's the elimination of a position in planning and a consolidation of the animal control officer with a prior administrative opening within the police department too. And our goal is to gradually free up money so that in the law enforcement area, we can have a greater presence on the streets, which is something we've discussed with council previously.
Okay. Okay. And chief, thank you for continuing to look for items that our community could need and and they're well thought out. So again, appreciate it and continue to
keep going down the road.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Mayor, Councilman Measure, thank you.
Thank you.
So we have item C, resolution 1502, application for funding and new apparatus, pumper tanker. Ms. Fambro and Chief.
Good afternoon, Mayor, council members. Before you have is a resolution applying for funding assistance for apparatus for the fire department, a pumper tanker in the amount of $670,000 in a $470,000 is a loan and $200,000 is in the current fire fund carryover money that we have in cash to help support this purchase. You have all the backup information. We did put we asked the finance authority for three options, and in discussing with Chief Gonzalez and Fambro, they've looked at it and what fits their needs best on that funding, those funding options. We've looked at the six-year loan because it takes away the debt service amount and they can afford the annual payment, which will come out of the fire fund allocation and be budgeted under the fire fund. I'll yield to Leroy to give you a little bit of history on the apparatus itself, since I just know the numbers.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Mr. Manager. This is a project that we've been working on for probably at least 4 or 5 years, trying to get a replacement pumper tanker for one of our apparatus, which is a 1989. According to NFPA 1901, anything over 25 years should be replaced and retired. This truck has done its job, and it's still in good condition. The only thing is that all the electrical, the braking mechanism, the engine, it's just from the older era. A lot better technology out there now. So we've been, like I said, it's been at least 5 years that we've been looking at this. We wrote a set of specs, which we sent to the fire marshal's office for their approval. And I have that letter, and I believe it was in your packet as well. And also stating what our minimum funding is as a class four, ISO class four, what our minimum amount is as well. I believe you have that in your packet, and we feel pretty confident. After meeting with finance, we went back up to 2000, back to 2010, I believe, and we looked at the fire fund budget and what we've spent out of it as far as for operations, and we feel pretty comfortable with going with the 6 year part of that. All our apparatus actually have been paid straight out, except for the last, this would be the first purchase that I've been involved in where we've had to finance part of it. But the reason for that is in the past, we were able to carry over monies year to year. The last 3 years, I spent almost $800,000 on two different apparatus on getting them replaced. So those were paid out straight out without having to get them financed. We're hoping to get this paid off early as well, if possible.
Councilor Peralta.
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, Marietta, I think, since you got the numbers. How much of the fire fund is budgeted? Do we have any outstanding loans right now?
No outstanding loans.
Okay, so how much is the fund? Because the packet I have doesn't have how much we get a per year.
Oh, okay.
It just has the quote from the finance authority to on a 10-year or 5-year note.
Right. On the letter from the fire marshals is in there, they get a base amount of $178,836 a year.
Okay,
and
because I don't have that. Okay.
Oh. Okay, because it should be attached to the end of the resolution. But if not, that's their base amount?
That's the minimum of amount. We've always got a little bit more than the minimum.
Okay, and how much of that is committed for annual operations?
Do you have that one?
Mr. Mayor, Councilman Peralta, after going back, like say from 2010, we've been looking at, last year was our biggest expenditure from the state fire funds due to the fact that we put a maintenance program together for our trucks out of that fund. And also we, as required by the state fire marshal's office and ISO, we completed all our testing as far as hose testing, and $80,000 was the expenditures last year. I don't anticipate that in the next few years as far as that amount.
Okay.
The operating budget this year for the fire fund under that was $211,000, and their capital expense was $294,000, but we've purchased some stuff and they have that $200,000 in the budget to pay for this truck. So like Leroy said, he's averaging 80, 75, 50 for those major operations. We have carryovers like grant match that they still will have in there. And that is the base, but last year we got 225, previous year 216,000, 221. So, but they didn't take that extra money into consideration. So that's why we feel comfortable. We use the 178 because that's what we had to start with.
Yes, we use the lower amount as far as figuring out if we can afford this.
So the estimated annual payments is, according to the finance authority, would be about $110,000 a year?
Actually, it's option six.
On a 5 year?
It's option six, which is $83,000 a year. And that is also, should be attached as an email memo, I think I have as attached.
That's what I give you. Yeah.
83 for six-year loan.
If you're looking at the email, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, it jumps 5-year, 10-year, okay, and then the following it. Pages.
Okay. Okay. So it's 6 years. Okay. Mr. Mayor, the only problem I have on this is that the resolution does not have the length of time for the loan that the council is going to be obligated to pay.
Actually, the resolution is just for us to apply. We're going to have to come back with a whole resolution document with the actual funding information.
Okay, but the resolution should also have the length of time that you're asking us to apply for, because the council's applying for it. And so the length of period of time for the application should include in your resolution in the application, as well as coming back as an approval when they approve that they've looked at our finances and we can afford it, then they'll come back and say, yes, you can, we will do it.
Right.
But our resolution should indicate that we're applying for a 6-year loan.
I use the standard NMFA resolution that he sent me, and he has to take this to the board with the information that we requested. I can call him and ask him if we have to include in this, because I know we're going to have to come back.
I'm saying as a council, we have to include it.
Right.
Not what MFA wants. As a council making a decision to borrow money, we have to indicate to the public that we're borrowing money for 6 years and we're using the fire fund to pay that back.
Okay. I will include it because the application is part of the approval. And the application has for the, it does not have the options, because we didn't have the options ready. And he said we just needed to submit the application and throw in the options. So I will amend the resolution to include that, but it's not specific yet because these are just draft numbers. So the 6-year term at $470,000 is what I can include somewhere in this resolution, with the attorney fixing it for me.
Is he asleep or awake?
He's awake. So, Council, I just want to, and Chief, I thank you for moving forward and applaud you for, you know, continuing to upgrade, and also Chief Rambro. I just want to kind of complicate this a little bit more. Maybe I shouldn't, but, you know, you guys are the backup for the Ski Valley. The Ski Valley and their new TID process, I didn't hear anything about public safety, and I know they, you know, they plan on building bigger buildings, higher buildings, your ladder truck and stuff like that. Is there any possibility of the county supplies the ambulance, we supply fire backup up there. Is there any possibility that we can tap into any of that, for part of this? I know you're the backup. I mean, if they need a ladder truck to fight fires in one of those hotels or stuff, you're the people that do it. I mean, is there any collaboration with them at all? You know, I don't want to convolute this, because I know we need this even within our own, sure, you know, municipality and in the county, but I'm just asking a question.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, at this time, we do have MOUs with, like I said, the Village of Ski Valley, with Red River, with all the departments within the Enchanted Circle. As far as asking the funding part, maybe Commissioner Fambro has pushed there.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, Mr. Bellis. My understanding is the Ski Valley is going to bring that TID to us for negotiation late February, early March. I'll certainly bring that in. I hadn't really looked outside the box in that angle, but that's certainly one. The TID is not only for the ongoing construction, it's for a proposed construction that they're going to unveil at that time. So it's in the tune of about over $75 million. So certainly part of that should reflect what the town and the county does. So I'll defend that when we negotiate that with them.
Yeah, I think most important thing is public safety. I mean,
well, they're not going to get it. They're not going to get insurance for their buildings if we don't buy into the plan.
Mr. Mayor, you may want to look at the legalities within that TID, because I've been following it pretty closely, and a lot of it is tied strictly to infrastructure. So
even the new one?
Okay. The whole thing is
the one
tied
that's
to,
coming up?
And the repayment is tied to gross receipts tax alleviation
right.
from the state of New Mexico portion and the Ski Valley portion to all going back towards paying the repayment of the TID. And the way it's supposed to work is that Ski Valley will upfront the money, the Inc. will upfront the money with the intention that the reimbursement will come back from the village. That's why it's a collaborative effort. I mean, it really is, the application is running through the village as a governmental entity, but it's done for the purpose of infrastructure, for water infrastructure improvement, electric, natural gas, et cetera. So it won't encompass public safety because it's not part of the inclusion.
Well, and the amount that they're attempting to reclaim in that TID is certainly under negotiation. I know what their initial offer is, and that could still be.
But I think through the TID itself, it is only, the mechanism itself is only geared towards infrastructure. Mm-hmm. It's not geared towards any other public safety aspect. So upon those guidelines, it may be an issue you want to raise with them, is saying, look, it's going to be fine.
Especially on the new future project.
Yeah, and I know it addresses water infrastructure, which may help with regards to fire hydrants and whatnot, but it's not going to address the serviceability of the fire department themselves.
Mr. Mayor, Chief, you may also want to check, I'll have our new planning director look at it, but my recollection is that the International Building Code actually prevents the licensing and the granting of a permit to a set of plans for a structure that you cannot provide fire prevention to. So they either need an MOU with you because they don't have anything that can reach three stories now. But I'll get that language for you and we can send it up there.
Thank you.
Okay. So, go ahead. Unrelated to what we're going to talk
to
about right now. To the chief. The question is, what happens with the old pumper? The question is about, you know, what do we do
like
with it?
I like the answer.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, at this time, what we would do if we got this approved and we got this ordered, we would just move it down to Station 3 at this time. We have room for it there at this particular time. We're kind of hoping that we get something built at the airport later on down the line if any expansion goes on to put something over there. I've been approached by different departments in the county as well that they have interest in it.
Are they willing to pay us retail?
Well, that would retail? Just be government to government on that.
Something. Are these on, Renee?
And I also had a discussion with the fire marshal's office last week, I believe. They called me and asked me to keep it under consideration as well. If this does go through, they have a couple of little departments in the state that are hurting really bad for some apparatus. I told them that once all this was done and we
are
got the final.
Are they willing to bid on it?
I'll leave that to the fire marshal's office to answer to you.
Real quick, Mr. Mayor, Commissioner Fabro, I'll put your commissioner hat on now. As we were going through this last election and whatnot, the county made it pretty evident that they had done their due diligence because we've always put back on them, well, we provide fire suppression, they provide EMS services. They made a pretty clear statement that they were doing their due diligence in operating more regional fire stations or throughout the county. With that, I guess I would just ask you to keep that in mind that we've provided, and you know, we've provided services for the county for quite a while. So irregardless, I just want to make sure that they're up to what they're supposed to be even, and we're not taken away from the core of the largest, your district, in District 2.
completed our strategic planning for the next budget cycle yesterday, and the mention of the future plans, which were started by the outgoing commission, will certainly be other stations, and it'll take some of the burden off of our department. But we're not going to do it because myself and Leroy have been committed to those people to give them the best service and ISO rating so that their homeowners insurance will be affordable. And we're not going to give up any of our district that's been established since before the town and county were established until we know that those citizens are taken care of. And so once that it can be done to where the fiscal impact on those people is minimalized, then I think we should be looking at other stations within our district. But currently in Pilar, Pot Creek, assistance in TP, I mean, we need coverage to beef those up before we start taking chunks, I think, here in the central part, because it doesn't make sense that we're gonna double the service when we still have places in the county that don't have service. But certainly in the pledge that I ran under, and I know that other people ran under, we're gonna work together on this, Councilman. And we're going to do what's best for the people between the entities, whether it be economic development, whether it be fire protection, or whether it be EMS.
And that's been my concern, Commissioner, is that it gets to a point where it's an us versus them mentality. Or, you know, we're doing our part
that
within the county.
Ended,
and it needs to stop because of the fact that we're still all one community.
So
I mean, our residents that visit the city may live in the county, but they don't have fire.
As long as we keep talking and we keep our relationship going and keep Grumpy there from giving me the stink eye over there that he is and everything. I'm kidding. But, you know, Councilman Han goes to our meetings. Councilmember Cantu goes to our meetings, you know. So we're well informed. And I was warned about coming over here to the Evil Empire. But, you know, I took a chance. I know some of you guys from before.
We're not that evil.
I'm
Your
kidding.
Your wife works
I'm
for
absolutely
us.
As a matter of fact, to show you collaboration, both myself and Mayor Barrone are on the NCRTD board, and we travel together and we talk about fishing and hunting and we make the best of a very long early Friday each month and stuff, and I'm honored to be there. And then, you know, French came and gave us the briefing the other day on Medio, and we're happy to say that we think we're gonna get through this budget cycle with a zero. We're not gonna have a deficit for the first time, you know, this year, and that still is with our commitment to what we're putting on Medio. So, you know, it's only going to get better, but have faith at least in the public service that's the good guys that everyone loves to be around and everything, not those gun-carrying guys over there. But we're going to do the best. Leroy and myself have worked, like you said, on this truck close to 6 years, and we know that that's what we best need, not just for the town, but it is big deal of this is going to be in the county. We're not going to lie to you. And as long as we keep working together and everything, we might surprise you and have something and to put forth with some other departments. We're gonna be working on that. But as long as we work together, we can get anything done.
Good deal. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, while the commissioner's here, I just want to inform you, I sent a notice over to the county, and I think the mayor probably tomorrow will send a formal invitation. But on the 27th, 2 weeks from today, we do have at 9 o'clock in the morning MFA coming to talk about how they were progressing on the Regional Housing Authority, affordable housing development capacity, and some of the programs up here, followed by DOT to talk about the corridor study, to talk about the light at Albright, the condition of the highway, lighting. And certainly we want to extend, while we have the opportunity on camera, a formal invitation to the county commissioners, because we believe that these are issues that affect all of us.
I found that I'm not short of meetings, but that's definitely a good one. We do have our mid-year budget review that day, so I'm not sure what the time is on the 27th, but hopefully we can work both if we have enough. That is something that we need to be a part of. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. We also are in the process of inviting the Economic Development Commission from the state, which is Main Street, that group.
What? Thank you. What?
So in other words, plan a day to be in meetings.
That's why I came to this meeting. I was having withdrawal and had one in about 10 minutes.
So, Council, what is the wishes of the Council? I know that Councilman Peralta made a recommendation, and I think Marietta was going to include that in the resolution 1502. So, during the approval process, just to make reference to that modification of the resolution.
Move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
Second. I wasn't denying you your truck. I just wanted to meet the procurement requirements of the state and state statute that we have to say how much we're borrowing.
I have to meet procurement to go get groceries. Give me a break.
You mean she takes your check away from you?
What check?
I get paid for this?
So, Mr. Mayor, if I could modify that the modification to the application is for a 6-year loan with the MFA.
Okay, with my motion.
Okay, so we have a modification and a motion and a second. Call for the vote.
Real quick, Mr. Mayor, under discussion, just moving forward with regards, Marietta, to any items that we get, much like we had the chief's out-of-state travel for the previous A and B two items, just so that the backup can be given that we know what we're expending when we're approving these items, you know, just like term loans and stuff like that. Just helps us immensely. And a lot of this stuff can maybe be alleviated on the question side to go through even items of consent as opposed to having to ask every single question about it.
Yeah, I apologize. I didn't have the figures before I got here, and then I got them in between, and I just inadvertently didn't put them back into the Novus because we didn't have them. But I apologize for that. I will do that. I'm pretty good at putting a lot of information. This one, I just missed that. Sorry. Good.
Thank you, Marietta.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Call for the vote.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Hunt?
Yes.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Go enjoy your truck. Thank you. Soon.
So item D, amendment number one on contract TT-1501 with Griffin Associates. Mr. Rick?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We received a $40,000 grant from New Mexico State Tourism, and since our sole agent, contracted agent for providing marketing and advertising is Griffin and Associates, and actually we identified him in the contract, we want to just amend the contract to reflect a couple of things. One is the addition of this $40,000. The second is we included also in that package an identification of the funds to date, and it appears there will not be the level of revenues available. I think we were optimistic and thought there might be a 2% increase. That may happen. It hasn't happened so far. But we also wanted to clarify some other terms that had come up, such as the commission rate, so that there was no dispute going forward. I would like to just change one thing on there, if Marietta and the attorney are happy at that. If you look on the agreement, the contract agreement, it has some language that kind of contradicts itself. The state says only 50% of the money can be spent before January 1st, and it says that the contract is not effective until the date it is signed by both parties, and of course we just received this more after January 1st. And then under payment, section 2 compensation C, it says you must apply quarterly as follows. The first and second quarter combined, July 1, 2014 through December 31st, 2014, and then before the expiration of contract, the third quarter in state fiscal year, January 1 through March 31st. So in effect, the language contradicts itself in saying that you actually need to bill us for periods prior to the contract being initiated. And I'm presuming that's because there was a delay in getting these contracts out. So in our agreement, since Griffin had assumed they would just ask for reimbursement of work that it was already done, and we were uncomfortable with that, under 1D, where it says worker items charged against New Mexico tourism grant number, et cetera, in an amount not to exceed $40,000 of grants, receipts, tax, which cannot precede the effective date of the grant. And I would like to insert the word "and." The work cannot be duplicative of work already submitted to and reimbursed by the town of Taos to the vendor, comma, unless agreed to by the town of Taos and New Mexico Tourism.
Councilor Peralta?
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I read reading the grant agreement from tourism, doesn't it say that the money has to be spent on advertising that they're doing And in other words, the $40,000 they give us has to go back with cooperative advertising that they're doing in the state. And in addition to that, we have to add another $40,000 to that amount. At least that's the way I read the grant. So it would eliminate the ability of Griffin and Associates or us to come up with a new idea. We have to kind of say, okay, what are you doing? And then we pick and choose what they're doing that we want to tag on to. Is that the way I read it?
Yeah, Councilman, that's the way I read it. However, the clarification that was provided to Griffin and ourselves was that it has to be New Mexico True campaign authorized and pre-approved advertising. And what Griffin has done, I guess, in previous grants is they make sure that all the advertising meets the New Mexico True format and is sent to them in time to be approved.
Yeah, but the way I read the grant, it says that these are buys that the department's making, not buys that Griffin Associates would make that would meet their criteria. It's actually, let's say, example, if they wanted to advertise in Condé Nast, we have to advertise in Condé Nast along with them as a cooperative member of that advertising. So we could get a section next to theirs, and we would piggyback on their purchasing power. But we couldn't go out and say and buy in Traveler's magazine if that wasn't one of New Mexico True's placements. I mean, that's the way I read it. So and so I looked at it as being very restrictive, and it makes it really difficult for our advertising group to really make any decisions on what they feel about what New Mexico True is doing, if that's going to really help us or hurt us. We just have to piggyback on them.
The councilman, the grant actually included a fairly detailed budget, which I was happy to see, on how much hours on Pandora, all the way down to print ad, specific radio and TV stations, and it was approved as an attachment to this grant. So, again, I'm having the same problem you have, is that what it says in the contract we're given is not what the department approved, and it conflicts with its own language. So I think the best thing we can do is provide language that protects us with our contractor and makes the contractor responsible for all of the terms of the contract, and that they verify those terms and confirm that to us prior to committing to the work and our being obligated and the state being obligated to reimburse for it.
And I guess maybe what I would be, you know, because I think it's good that we should do this. It's just that I want to make sure that we don't get into a catch-20 situation where we go ahead and ask for reimbursement and say, oh, but you didn't attach it to the right advertisement. So, sorry, guys, but you're out. And so maybe the question is, as part of this, is that we get a letter of clarification from the department, since we have a new secretary, as to the defining specifically what they're talking about, because it says using their toolbox, but I don't know whether that toolbox really works when you're talking about the language in the actual contract on how you have to do things. So I agree with you, there's some conflict in there, but I think we need to get a clarification from them so that we do make the expenditures properly and get properly reimbursed for us and our contractor.
And Mayor, Council, I have no problem with tabling this. I don't think that another 2 weeks is critical to this contract. And particularly, I share your concern in the change in administrations, in that the representations we have verbally are from people that are no longer there. And new people not being familiar might come in and take a strict interpretation. Mm-hmm. So I guess Mr. Mayor's staff would request that the item be tabled to the next meeting.
Did you have something?
I just wanted to see, do we have a checks and balances that just makes sure that she's not getting reimbursed for something she's already been paid for?
Well, Councilwoman, that's the exact language I put in there, is that she could not submit for reimbursement of materials that she'd already been paid for by the town.
Okay. Cool beans.
Okay. So the request was to go ahead and table it so he can look into that, Council?
Mr. Mayor, move the table till the next meeting.
Okay.
I'll second.
Next regular meeting, correct? Okay. So, a motion and a second. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. town manager's under others, anything else from staff? If not, we'll go to town manager's report.
Mr. Mayor, just very quickly to report that per our emails, on the 26th, we have scheduled MFA at 9 o'clock. That's 2 weeks from today. It'll be your next regular meeting date. At 11 o'clock, we have NMDOT scheduled, the regular meeting at 1 o'clock, and we have made a request and are waiting for confirmation as to whether New Mexico Economic Development Department can come here and to talk about programs they have available, LIDA, Main Street, and some other items. Also scheduled for that meeting, I've asked Matt Scritt, I've asked Matt Spriggs to do a short economic development update based on the most recent quarterly statistics we have, which we're trending up in some important areas. And I had promised Councilwoman Cantu that we would have both a resolution prepared for consideration of any events that might require the closure of the plaza for the next calendar year, as well as comprehensive a calendar of proposed events by the town and other community organizations, as we might be aware of for the coming year. We are still looking at the 26th, the date before, to have a one-day workshop to fit into the retreat format to do goal setting, as long as everybody can make that meeting. And that's all I have at this time.
One real quick thing, Mr. Mayor, just for the general public, that those meetings with the Department of Transportation and Department of Economic Development Department are open to the public, so they are welcome to participate as well, too.
I did want to say, too, that I know that a few people have talked about that there seems to be mud or sand on the roads. It's been a little difficult, and I noticed it walking over here, particularly in the alleyways, that it's starting to accumulate where we don't get sun and the ice has built up, runs off the buildings and into the alley. That will, as soon as this next snowstorm passes through and we clean those alleys, we'll also clean those streets.
Okay. All right, anything else on this item, Mr. Manager?
No, sir.
Okay. Not at this time. So we'll go on to matters and reports from the mayor, and we'll look at resolution 1501, open meeting resolution. Floyd and Renee.
Mayor and council members, the open meetings resolution is before you. We're required by the Open Meetings Act to set the schedule for each calendar year. And so the schedule is set in the open meetings resolution, and it basically says that your council meetings will be held on the second and the fourth Tuesday of every month at 1 o'clock p.m. And it also sets the timeline that we're required to notify the public of these meetings, which is set also by the Open Meetings Act, and that is 72 hours prior to the meeting. And Floyd has looked at the resolution, he's approved it, he made a few grammatical corrections, but other than that, it stayed basically the same as it did last year.
Move for approval, Mr. Mayor.
We have a motion, we have a second to that.
Second.
And a second. Any further discussion? Councilor Peralta.
Never mind, I found what I'm looking for.
Okay. All right, any other discussion? Not, call for the vote.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
So under item B, other matters, I'd just like to direct staff. I know we have a new governor, lieutenant governor, and war chief at the Pueblo. Be nice to set up a meeting and at least meet them, and so I'd like to direct staff to get that meeting set up and invite as many council members that want to be there, at least to get introductions and learn who everybody is. Okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Could you include us in that meeting if you do set something else, please?
Okay, we can do that. So then we'll go to matters and reports from council. Start with you, Councilor Hahn.
I'm clear, thank you.
I just have one thing to bring up. The hospital board is having interviews with three potential candidates for the permanent CEO today, tomorrow, and Thursday, and then Thursday there'll be a special board meeting to see whether the board wants to consider any one of those three candidates and make them an offer to be the new permanent CEO. The current interim CEO does not want the permanent job. She likes what she does, which is, I think this is her fourth or fifth time that she's been an interim CEO, and she's doing a very good job. She's excellent. But I think she likes it, you know, gives her a little time off and doesn't have to dedicate 80 hours a day or a week, you know, permanently. So I think that's one reason she doesn't want to do that at her time in her career. But the three candidates that we're looking at on paper look very good, but we'll see what happens after the interviews are over.
Open to the public?
No.
These are all
Thursday
private.
Night?
Thursday, you said?
It'll be Thursday. Tentatively, it's 10:30, but I can't understand that because we have an interview at 10, I think, or 10:30. So it's
I see.
It'll be after that.
Okay. Stephen has a question back there.
Steve, you had a... Come on up so we can hear you. And
is the regular board meeting still tomorrow evening?
No, the regular board meeting is the
28th.
Third or fourth Wednesday of the month. I'm sorry?
I thought it was the second.
No, I believe it's the fourth.
Right, so the next board meeting, Stephen, is the 28th.
Mm-hmm.
Next hospital health study is the 4th of February.
Okay, all right.
See me after if you...
Councilor Gonzalez, do you have anything?
I don't have anything, Mr.
Councilor Cantu?
No, I don't have any reports.
Okay.
I have a few questions.
Questions?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I just, you know, we got a pretty loaded email the other day, and I'm just really curious where we're standing as far as a public meeting for the merchants and when we're going to hear more about the farmers market and who all from the farmers market is planning on participating. That is something that I think people even came here today because they thought it was on the agenda.
No. You know, what we promised Councilor Cantu and, you know, is that before any decisions is made on where the farmers market is going to be held, we would have a public meeting. And that's what we're trying to set up right now, is a public meeting. It'll probably be, hopefully we can get the use of the old county courthouse, and we'll have that public meeting there. After the public meeting has taken place, then there will probably be an agenda item that we have a current contract currently with the farmers market. And in that new request, they're asking not only to have the farmers market within property, but maybe specific to the plaza. So we want to make sure before we have this, that we have that open and transparent town meeting that we promised. I believe you were part of that.
Yeah, and, I was wondering, we have a contract with them. When was that signed?
And that's been in place. That's been in place for at least 4 years now. I think the previous council did that. And we can either renew it or not renew it, or there's some different options that could take place. But that's, again, something that will come back to the council for to move forward on or not move forward on.
Okay, so then we, the town of Taos, are holding the public meetings for the merchants and...
Yes.
Mr. Mayor.
And not only just for the merchants, it's a open meeting to all the public, the merchants, the you know, the citizens, the, you know, plaza belongs to the citizens, so they hope they have input. I hope they show up.
Mr. Mayor, I'd ask that we hold it in a different venue besides the county courthouse, and number one reason, because of ADA accessibility, and being that it is a public meeting, just to make sure that we accommodate to everybody that can, that wants to attend, can attend, in a safe capacity.
Any suggestions, Counselor?
Here, or
I don't think
next
this
door, we can use the county commission chambers, I'm sure. I mean, there's plenty of public venues. I just think to hold it in a place such as the county courthouse, which we're all happy to visit, or the old county courthouse, I've just had some complaints on when we're going to address the ADA issue.
Okay, we can get it moved around. I'm sure we can ask, or we can hold it here. That's fine, too. I don't know if, yeah, we can do that. Anything else? Do you have a question, Councilor?
No, that was just to make sure that we have ADA compliance for the meeting so that everyone has an opportunity, if they want to come, to have that ability in the county courthouse. Love it, but until it gets ADA compliant, it's difficult, and we could have somebody challenge our meetings by not being able to get there.
Okay. Mr. Bellis?
Schedule it for the 29th, Thursday the 29th, for here in this room.
Thursday the 29th?
At 6 p.m.
6 p.m. And we will do our best. We'll try to get it in the newspaper. We'll try to get it to the merchants, and it's on TV right now. So any help we can get from the counselors to get that and disseminate that information.
And Mr. Mayor, I think in response to one of the questions that Councilor Cantu started to ask about the farmers markets, that the dispute or how many people were competing, we've held a number of meetings with those groups, and we've reached an agreement with all of them to work together, and each of them sort of have an area of responsibility. And actually, they're proposing some pretty exciting things, and it'll also address some concerns people have had in the past about getting back and forth to cars by using a horse-drawn wagon as sort of a hayride fun feature, and petting zoo, and some other ideas that they're proposing. And as you indicated, Mayor, as soon as we have a location in mind, we'll ask that market to make a presentation.
And again, there's been no decisions on where the market is being held. It's just they want a contract, again, either extending the contract or moving forward with, so that there's not this, they have an idea where they're going to tell their farmers that it's going to be held. So that's the whole idea, is they want to know themselves. So. Mm-hmm. And open, as transparent as we can be. So we went through that. So we have a motion to go into executive session under pending litigation, and under 1015-1H7, and under B, water rights, under 1015-1H8. Council? Nobody wants to go into executive?
We'll go into executive session.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
And a second. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Motion to come back into regular session out of the executive session, Councilor. A motion and a second. Call for the vote, Mr. Lopez.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Here.
Okay, Mr. Lopez, return to you about executive session.
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, we adjourned to executive session to discuss two matters regarding pending or threatened litigation pursuant to Opening Meetings Act Exemption 1015-187, and three matters concerning the purchase or disposition of water rights pursuant to Exemption 1015-1H8. No other matters were discussed, and no action was taken on those matters.
A motion to accept the town attorney's report?
Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes.
Towning.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Council. Just for the record, because we had stated earlier that the meeting for the downtown businesses would be held in this chambers at 6 o'clock on Thursday the 29th, and that was predicated on our not making a publication deadline. The newspaper has said it will be in Thursday's paper and the following Thursday, so it'll actually be Thursday, 6 p.m., the 22nd in this room. And anyone that's interested in the downtown events, the parking issues, the signage, the lighting, or any other issues of concern in the downtown, we'd be pleased to have you here.
And we would make it every effort to get it on as a PSA, or even if we had to pay for it at the radios.
It will be on the radios.
Should be a PSA.
Yeah,
but
why are we paying?
Yeah, I just to make sure.
We don't
sure.
Got the dough.
Yeah, I agree. But we have a motion to adjourn.
Well, there's one other matter, Mr. Mayor, but I wanted to get the time for this meeting on the 22nd again.
6 o'clock.
And that's here at the council chambers?
Correct.
Council. All right. There was one other matter, and one of the water rights matters we discussed, I asked for guidance concerning a letter to be sent, and I would ask that permission be granted in open session.
So move.
You have a second to that motion?
Second.
Okay. Call for the vote.
Councilmember Cantu?
Yes.
Councilmember Gonzalez?
Yes.
Councilmember Peralta?
Yes.
Councilmember Hahn?
Yes, sir.
Any other thing, anything else? Okay, do we have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
We have a second.
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.